During the time of Bernadette, the parish church in Lourdes was the Church of St. Peter. It stood near the town centre in the area known as Place Beramal, where we now find the tourist information and a prominent war memorial. The Church of St. Peter was where the Subaru family would regularly attend Mass. It was where Francois and Louise were married in 1843. It is also where Bernadette was baptised on the 9th of January, 1844. Her baptism took place when she was 2 days old, on the day of her parents' first wedding anniversary. The parish priest during the apparitions of 1858 was Father Dominique Peramal. He lived in the nearby presbytery. He was a charitable and intelligent man. A 14-year-old Bernadette would visit him and talk to him about the lady from the Rock of Massabielle. One important message conveyed by Bernadette during these visits was, "The lady wants a chapel." Father Beramal was not unkind to Bernadette, but initially took a cautious approach to her story. He told her to ask the lady her name. And indeed, after the 16th apparition, when Our Lady spoke the words, "I am the Immaculate Conception," in Bernadette's local dialect, it was straight to Father Beramal that the little girl rushed, repeating the phrase all the way for fear of forgetting the words which she had heard but not understood. These words proved to be a turning point for Father Beramal, and he became a great pioneer in convincing the church authorities to recognise Bernadette's story. The two remained firm friends even after Bernadette left Lourdes in 1866, exchanging letters and praying for one another. The church requested by the lady was built. It is the Basilica of the Immaculate Conception, or the Upper Basilica, in the sanctuary. Whilst Father Beramal was still serving as parish priest in Lourdes, work began for a new church in the town in 1875. This church was to be dedicated to the Sacred Heart, or Sacré-Cœur. Construction was paused in 1877 following the death of Father Beramal and resumed in 1896. Now, the current parish church in Lourdes stands just a minute's walk from the site of the old one. The building was a project undertaken by Father Beramal and is a testimony to the huge contribution he made to the town of Lourdes. In 1904, St. Peter's Church was destroyed by fire. Only very few items were saved from the blaze, one being the original baptismal font. This font was placed in the new parish church of Sacred Heart. It means that by paying a visit to the new parish church, we are lucky enough to be able to see the very font in which Bernadette was baptised. Even today, many children from the parish of Lourdes have had the privilege of being baptised in the same font. On the wall over the font, we see a copy of the charred remains of Bernadette's baptismal certificate, which was also salvaged from the fire. Other salvaged items include the statues of St. John the Baptist and of the mother and child in gilded wood, also found in Sacré-Cœur. To the left and right of the main aisle, we can see many side altars dedicated to Saint Joseph, Saint Thérèse, and the Holy Family, among others. To the left of the main altar, we find an altar dedicated to Saint Bernadette, who incidentally never visited this church. There, we find a beautiful painting depicting Bernadette during one of the apparitions, and a reliquary containing a first-class relic of the local saint. Father Beramal's tomb is found in the crypt of Sacred Heart. The entrance to this beautiful little chapel is situated to the right of the main church. The new church was consecrated in 1903. In spring 2018, extensive renovation work began on the Sacré-Cœur, and it continues to this day. We hope we shall soon be able to visit this very special church again.
In the 1830s and 1840s, the Beaulieu Mill was run by the Castéron family. Justin and Claire Castéron used to grind corn into flour for the locals, and they ran quite a successful business. Things were going well for the family until in 1841, Justin Castéron was killed in a carting accident on the outskirts of Lourdes. Claire decided that now was the time to marry off her eldest daughter, because it was clear that they needed a man around the mill to do the heavier tasks. So now was the time for her eldest daughter Bernard, who was 19 years old, to find a husband. She believed that a local bachelor called François Soubirous, who was himself a miller, would be the perfect match for Bernard. However, François had already fallen in love with a much younger daughter, Louise, who at 16 years old was about half of his age. Claire took some convincing because of the significant age difference between François and Louise, but François would marry Louise or no one, and so she eventually gave her consent for them to marry. François and Louise got married on the 9th of January in 1843. The young couple lived with the in-laws and they worked in the mill. Claire Castereau and Bernard continued to oversee the running of the mill and kept a very close eye on the income and expenditure. In 1848, Claire, her son and three daughters left the mill, and this allowed François and Louise to create a family home at last. Joy filled the Bowley Mill on the 7th of January in 1844 with the arrival of the Soubirous' first daughter. The baby was called after her aunt and godmother, Bernard, and we now know her as Bernadette. Bernadette was baptised when she was 2 days old on the 9th of January in 1844 on her parents' first wedding anniversary. Bernadette lived for most of the first 10 years of her life in the Bowley Mill. She called it her home of happiness. The love and security she felt here stood to her during the many challenging times, particularly in later life. When she was an infant, however, her mother was burnt by a candle and could no longer nurse Bernadette, and so the baby was fostered out to a wet nurse in Bartres called Marie Aravon Lagousse. Marie Lagousse had just lost a son and was therefore able to be Bernadette's wet nurse during Louise's recovery. The wet nurse was reluctant to allow Bernadette to return to her family once Louise had made a full recovery, though. François missed his firstborn daughter very much and found every excuse to visit her as often as he could in Bartres. When Bernadette was almost 2.5, she returned to live with her family in the Bowley Mill. She lived there until she was 10, often helping her parents in the mill instead of going to school. The Soubirous were known for their generosity. The needy, and indeed sometimes the greedy, called to the Bowley Mill in need of flour or food, sometimes even clothing. François and Louise gave what they had with generosity of spirit, telling the recipients that they could pay them back when they were able to. However, eaten bread is soon forgotten, and the Soubirous' outlay way surpassed their income, leaving them unable to pay their own rent on their home and their business. And so in 1854, the year when Pope Pius IX declared the dogma of the Immaculate Conception, the Soubirous family were evicted from the Bowley Mill. Bernadette was just 10 years old. François became a brassier, or a day labourer, and Louise did housekeeping and laundry for the better off families of Lourdes. Sometimes she had to work in the fields, anything to help feed her family and to pay the rent. Bernadette had to work too, looking after her little sister and brothers while her parents worked. She also gathered wood, bones, and scrap iron to sell. Going to school was not an option at that time. During this time, the Soubirous moved to a number of other mills, both in Lourdes and on the outskirts of the town. But in September 1857, the family found themselves within days of sleeping on the streets. Their only hope of having a roof over their heads was to move into an old, disused jail cell in the cachot or dungeon, vacated a few years earlier because of its deplorable living conditions.
As you may recall, the Soubirous family moved home quite a few times after leaving the Bowley Mill, due to the fact that they were unable to pay the rent. In 1857, the family were thrown out of their house once again because they were unable to meet the rent. They ended up on the streets. Nobody wanted to know about their plight. Nobody wanted to help them, even though they had helped so many during their time at the Bowley Mill. At that time, the old jail, or cachot, was being leased by a cousin of Francois. The building had ceased to be a prison around 1824 because the conditions in it at that time were deemed too unhealthy to house prisoners. But in 1857, the Soubirous were desperate. With no other choice available, Francois went knocking on his cousin's door. The conditions were appalling. The room was musty and damp. Mildew covered the walls. Rats had moved in. The smell from the dung heap outside the window permeated the dark, filthy hovel, as it was described locally. Saint-Just didn't think it was suitable accommodation for any family, but there were four young children about to be left on the streets with no roof over their heads, and so with a heavy heart, he agreed to give the room to the Soubirous. Francois, Louise, and their four children moved into the tiny room in the cachot. Installing their belongings didn't take long. Francois worked as a day labourer, hiring the strength of his arms out for a pittance. He also worked from time to time, delivering flour for the baker. But misfortune came his way once again in March 1857, when two gendarmes arrived at the cachot to arrest Francois. Two sacks of flour had gone missing from the bakery, and all fingers were pointing at the father of four. Following intensive questioning and a search of the cachot, Francois was eventually released without charge. News of his accusation of theft had spread quickly, but the news of Francois's innocence, of course, hadn't. Therefore, finding a job became even more difficult for the misfortunate miller. His left eye continued to cause him both physical and psychological pain. He had lost his confidence as well as his vision. He was deemed unemployable by the locals, so Francois used to stay in bed all day to conserve energy. He refused to eat, therefore ensuring that his wife and children had more on their plates. However, when news spread that Francois had taken to his bed instead of earning money to feed his family, his reputation sank even further. The children helped to look after their humble home and also contributed in their small way to the running of the cachot by gathering twigs, bones, and old pieces of iron, which they sold in the second-hand shop. Hunger was commonplace in the cachot despite their efforts. A story is told of an unknown little boy found scraping wax off the floor of the parish church and eating it, anything to fill his stomach. It was later discovered during the apparitions that this little boy was Bernadette's little brother. We are also told that when Bernadette lived in the cachot, she used to fill a bowl with water, adding grass in an attempt to make soup. In September 1857, Bernadette went to live with her wet nurse in Bartres so that the Soubirous would have one less mouth to feed. Bernadette returned to Lourdes to the cachot on the 17th of January 1858. She had pleaded with the parish priest and the nuns who ran the hospice to help her prepare to receive her first Holy Communion. While she returned to the squalor of the cachot, she returned also to the love and warmth of her family. 11th of February 1858 was a damp, misty morning. The Soubirous had no wood left for the fire because they had sold their last log the previous day. Louise wasn't keen, but Bernadette and her sister Toinette, along with their friend Jeanne, begged permission to go looking for some firewood. She eventually conceded, but not before warning Bernadette, who suffered from asthma, to wrap up well and not to get her shoes and socks wet. The girls left the cachot, crossed the old bridge over the river, and arrived at the prairie, which is now the Rosary Square. Close to where the canal joins the River Gave, Bernadette stopped. This is where she would have to remove her shoes and socks so as not to get them wet when crossing the river. The other two girls continued and started to gather sticks and twigs, as well as old bones that had been dumped there by the butchers. As Bernadette bent down to remove her shoes and socks, she heard a sound like a gust of wind, but the trees were not moving. She looked around to see what had made the noise, and in the niche of the rock she saw a bright light. When she studied the light, she saw a beautiful lady dressed in white, and that was the first apparition on the 11th of February 1858. When Bernadette left the cachot on that cold, misty morning, she had no idea what lay ahead of her, and yet it was from this room, home to the poorest of the poor and the lowest of the low, that Bernadette left for the subsequent 17 apparitions, and indeed on several other occasions too, having felt the calling in her heart and knowing that the Lady, the Immaculate Conception, Our Lady of Lourdes, was calling her to the Rock of Massabielle.
The village of Bartres is situated about 4 kilometres from the town of Lourdes. Bernadette lived there briefly at 2 different times during her life. The first time was when she was just 10 months old. Her mother Louise had been burned by a candle in the Bony Mill and could no longer nurse Bernadette. Marie Aravon Lagus from Bartres had recently lost a baby boy and so was able and very willing to act as Bernadette's wet nurse. Bernadette's father, Francois, missed his firstborn daughter terribly and found every excuse he could to visit her. Bernadette remained in Bartres for about 18 months, long after Louise's injuries had healed. The reason for this was because her wet nurse did not want to let the little girl go. But during this time, the Soubrous had suffered their own loss. Their little baby boy, Jean, had died at just 2 months old, and they wanted Bernadette back home. And so, at the age of 2.5, Bernadette returned to Lourdes. In September 1857, Bernadette returned to Bartres when her family had fallen upon hard times back in Lourdes. The Soubrous had been evicted from several mills and were on the verge of being homeless. While Bernadette didn't want to leave her family, she knew it would help her parents if they had one less mouth to feed. So she moved back to Bartres, back to the home of her former foster mother. But this time she was there to work. At the age of 13, she was given the tasks of looking after the sheep, she was in charge of the household chores, and she had to tend to Marie Lagus's 8 children. This was a very difficult, lonely and challenging time for the young girl. At that time, Bernadette desperately wanted to receive her first Holy Communion. She therefore needed to know her catechism off by heart in French. But Bernadette didn't speak French. Instead, she spoke a local dialect called Patois, and during the apparitions, the lady spoke to Bernadette in this local dialect. One of the reasons why Bernadette agreed to go to Bartres was because she had understood that the parish priest in the village, Father Adair, would help her to prepare to receive her first Holy Communion. However, on arrival in the village, it became very clear that her long list of chores was to be her priority. And soon after, the parish priest left to join a monastery. So the job of teaching Bernadette her catechism was left up to her former wet nurse. This did not go well. We are told that Marie Lagus was a lady of very little patience, and Bernadette was just not used to learning. After all, she had only attended school sporadically during her childhood. She often called herself stupid, and this was usually confirmed to her by her former wet nurse. The improvised catechism classes were a failure. Bernadette begged her father to allow her to move back to Lourdes. She wanted to ask the sisters of the hospice for their help in preparing her to receive her first Holy Communion. In January 1858, Francois conceded, and Bernadette returned to live with her family in the misery that was the Cachot. Just 3 weeks later, on the 11th of February 1858, Bernadette saw the lady for the first time at the grotto of Massabielle. When we visit Bartres, the highlight is to visit the parish church dedicated to St. John the Baptist. It was originally built at the end of the 14th century. Bernadette often prayed and attended Mass here during her second stay in the village, from September 1857 until January 1858. She was very familiar with the 17th century triptych behind the altar, depicting 3 scenes from the life of St. John the Baptist. On the left, we have the Visitation. The center panel shows us the baptism in the Jordan. And the panel on the right shows the beheading of St. John the Baptist. There are statues on either side of the triptych. These statues are quite unusual because of the fact that each statue depicts two saints combined into one statue. The statue on the left-hand side of the triptych, as we look at the altar, represents two male saints, Saint Peter, holding the key to the kingdom, and Saint Paul, holding a book of epistles. The statue on the other side of the triptych, on the right-hand side as we look at the altar, represents two female saints. On the left side of the statue, we see Saint Catherine of Alexandria, who was condemned to be executed on the breaking wheel because she wouldn't renounce her faith. On the right is Saint Judith carrying her sword to save her people. Among the other artefacts of interest in the church, we find a first-class relic of Saint Bernadette, removed during the third exhumation of her body. We also see a page from Bernadette's notebook showing some of her first attempts at writing, dated the 16th and 17th of December 1858, when the little girl was almost 15 years old. In the graveyard which surrounds the church, we can visit the grave of Bernadette's wet nurse, Marie Aravon Lagus. Because of the very close connection which Bartres has with Lourdes, groups often like to celebrate Mass in Bartres Parish Church, followed by a wander around the beautiful little village. There they can enjoy some beautiful scenery, listen to the bird song, and maybe even enjoy some refreshments in the local cafes before boarding the coach back to Lourdes.